does it mean to be the town marshal? That's interesting because a lot of people don't understand what a town marshal is. They think we're federal. Town marshal is not a common thing, but the town of Camp Verde decided to keep the old style, you know, Western town marshal name. So I'm essentially the chief of police. My day-to-day business is to manage the public safety for the town of Camp Verde, and that's several different divisions that revolves around even the dispatch, regional dispatch center, and then the day-to-day patrol, and just manage the finances for the town and the taxpayers' money. That's my job, to just ensure the public safety for the town of Camp Verde.
Hi, I'm Lieutenant Dan Jacobs with the Camp Verde Marshal's Office. I'm the patrol lieutenant. We're fixing to give you guys a quick tour of our facility and just kind of let you know where everything's at. Alright, this is our reception area. This is Patty. She's our reception. We have records behind you, and we have my office is right over here for the patrol. So the marshal's office is back this way.
I always wanted to be a police officer because my uncle was a chief of police, and he worked narcotics, and he was kind of that Don Johnson, you know, type of thing. He drove the Porsche, and I thought it was just a cool lifestyle. Realized at a really young age that it was hard to make a living as a police officer, so I left and I went into the professional world, the business world, and did that up until my 30s. Worked for a family business, owned my own business, and then my business partner was killed in an auto pedestrian accident. I told my wife, I want to go back and be a cop again in my 30s. I've been a police officer for 16 years, and over half of that has been as a chief now. I went up that rank fairly quickly. I was able to attend the FBI National Academy, which is less than 1% of law enforcement administration gets chosen to be able to attend that academy, and I attended that academy, so I think that really helped out with my career path. So in Alaska, I was a chief in a couple different municipalities, and then having grandkids and being so far away because it was hard to travel from up there, it was time to come down here and get closer to family. So I happened to hear of a job announcement in Camp Verde. I was being pretty picky about, you know, I wanted a, you know, 30 to 40 man department that I could, you know, participate in, and it was a perfect fit.
And this is the dispatch center.
Come on in, guys.
As a dispatch supervisor, I oversee the dispatch room, all the dispatchers on duty. We currently have 8 dispatch positions. A 911 dispatcher answers 911. We only dispatch for law enforcement, so we send police officers to wherever they're needed to go.
Is it always dark?
Usually. Makes the screens easier to see over the time.
I started with the Camp Verde Marshal's office in August of 98 as a dispatcher. I moved into the evidence room for a number of years. I took the position as supervisor last summer. As a supervisor, I'm backup dispatcher when I'm on duty, if we're shorthanded. I still do take calls for service, but my job is more the administrative side of dispatch. So I help with, I make sure we have proper scheduling. I help write policy, help write training manuals, things like that. Do some of all on the back end technology information that we need to keep the center running.
So right here, this is our phone system. It's called Vesta, and it's kind of like, we organize it by like an electronical phone book. Every type of phone number we need will be in these little tabs. These right here is gonna be our 911 trunk lines. These are the lines that blow up if 911's going off. You'll see it light up red and have a loud ring to it. These are our admin lines. These ones will go on if someone's just coming on the non-emergency line. And these are our ring down lines right here. This one's directly connected with Cottonwood. So if we need fire or medical for any reason, we click on that and it goes directly into their dispatch center. And it's not so formal. They know it's us calling, so they'll just answer dispatch, and then we tell them what's going on. And then this right here is our door phone, so if someone's outside the front door and they hit the intercom, they can reach us. If the doors are locked, they can't come inside. These are extensions, and then everything here. This phone system is connected with this map up here, so when 911 goes off, it'll start automatically talking to it to give us our coordinates and our GPS and everything of the caller. There's 2 phases to it. There's phase 1 where it just hits the tower of your cell signal, your phone signal, and then phase 2 gives you a more narrowed down area of where that caller is. It's not always reliable, Sometimes you get a large radius, sometimes you get an actual house. It just depends. That's why the first thing that we ask when we answer the phone is 911, where is your emergency, to verify where they're at, whether they be at an intersection or a store or their actual residence. We also have these two other maps here that are outside of this system, and it's called Rapid Deploy, and their other one's called Rapid SOS. And it's all linked with the phone system as well, but also Google Maps. So we're able to see it like we're on Google Maps, and it's a little bit, sometimes it could be a little bit more reliable. So it's just extra tools that we have.
When I first started, we had a little screen about this big that had our Annie and Allie information. Annie and Allie are the number, the phone number, and the location of the people calling in. We only used to have just the phone number. Everybody called in based on a home phone. So that told us where you were. And we had three phone numbers, that lines basically. Now we have a whole computer system that runs our 911 system. We can now get, we have wireless, the phones that come in, we now know where you are within a, sometimes within a 10 meter range, which is within 30 feet of your exact location. We can see where you are inside of a building. We can now get text to 911. So it's gone from very basic information and basic phone calls to text to 911 and information that tells us where you are within 30 feet.
So if the phone goes off and they disconnect, we are able to send a text message, because some people will respond to the text message versus someone, a random phone number, calling them back. And it has the technology in it. If we know the other person possibly speaks a different language, we can text them in that language. So if someone calls and they're speaking Spanish to me and I can, you know, check your phone, I can send it, I can type it in English, it'll translate it to Spanish for them. They can type back in Spanish, it'll translate to English for us. And until we close the call, it will track that phone for us. So that's why I really like that system more than this one.
In the works, it's called Next Gen 911. In the works is, there's a lot of technology in the backside of redundancy so that we don't have to worry about computer failures, location failures, things like that, all the way up to the discussion of actually videos, live stream videos coming into dispatch. We're not there yet, but they're saying that that's coming within the next 5 to 10 years. Yavapai County is actually very advanced, much more so than some of the other counties. We've had text to 911 for almost 2 years now, where I believe it's just now getting into the bigger cities down in the valley. We have a consortium here, Yavapai County Sheriff's Office is actually the ones that are in charge of getting all that technology into us. We were actually one of the beta or the testing sites. A daily job for dispatcher changes every day. Friday nights are busy. Sunday mornings can be absolutely nothing. You might be sitting there waiting for the phone to ring, and then in 5 minutes you've got 4 residential house fires out in the Verde Lakes area. It just depends on what's going on in the world. I told you we only dispatch for police, but we do run with the fire departments a lot. Just because we have to, if we've got a residential fire, you've got to keep the scene secure, make sure the fire department can get in and get out and do their job safely.
911, where is your emergency? Main Street Holman, any injuries? Okay, what kind of vehicle are you in? Okay. And what kind of white Dodge truck and a purple Charger?
Camper units, minor injuries in an accident, Main and Holman. Main and Holman.
And what is your name? And what's a good callback number for you, Debbie? Okay, okay, what about the other person? Do you see them up and walking around? Okay. Are you guys blocking the intersection now? Okay, you said their neck hurts. Okay, we don't know about the other caller or the other person involved. All right, hang tight, and I'll send officers your way, and I'll also send medical to come check you out, okay? Call me back if anything changes.
Thank you.
Thank you. Sorry, So that was our, that would be me taking a traffic incident. I'll put in the call for service. So now I'm in practice, and basically how the call would be would just kind of like how you saw it. So this is our ad call screen. So she says she was on Holloman and Main Street, and I would just type in.
I heard you type in, they got it.
Yeah, because I pulled up a real call. I was about to enter. And then I'll just enter the nature of what it is. So it's a non-injury accident, could be injury. And then I type in all the information. Purple Charger is what she told me versus white Dodge truck. And then when I hit accept, it'll pop up on the screen. I think I accepted a real call.
No.
You sure?
Yep.
Okay.
It's not in.
So there it is. That's how that pops up. So if I was a call taker and then Susan over here is our dispatcher, she would automatically be listening in and then start dispatching officers to the vehicle accident while I'm inputting information. And it pops up live on her screen, everything that I enter. So she'll be able to update the officers in real time of what's going on, whatever the situation is. I prefer the radio. I'm a radio person, but we will trade off back and forth different days of what the one person's feeling versus the other.
Being able to multitask is one of the most important things we do here. Because we are a small center, sometimes you're answering the phone call as well as dispatching it out to the officers at the same time. So you have to be able to talk and type at the same time. You have to be able to talk and listen at the same time. You know, you might be having it's the complaint, the person calling you, telling you where this car is on the freeway and what it's doing, and you have to be able to repeat that out while you're typing all that information in. You need to be able to, basic typing skills are important, but primarily the ability to multitask is one of the most difficult things to teach somebody, but yet one of the most important things to do. Every dispatcher can handle every call on their own. We do have some that are more experienced, obviously. Before we put you, once you get through your training program, before we put you on the phone or out on your own, we make sure that you can handle most everything. The new dispatcher will not be on her own in the center by themselves for at least 6 to 9 months covering it, just because it's a safety thing. It's an officer safety thing. We're the officer's lifeline.
This right here is called our CAD system, and this is how we keep track of all of our officers and our calls for services. These numbers right here are gonna be all my units that are on duty today, and they're separated by their badge number and what agency they are. This block up here is gonna be the undispatched calls, so if my partner puts in a call for service, she answers the phone, call for service, it'll pop up here, and if I'm working the radio, I'll dispatch to an officer, it'll go down here, so I know that an officer is now handling this call, it's out of my hands, I don't need to do anything with it, and they're all just resting here. So it coordinates with the rest of Spillman is what our CAD system's called, and it coordinates with that, and that gives us the ability to run people, see if they have warrants, or run their vehicle, see if it's valid, and all that good stuff with their traffic stops, or whatever we need to do with the call that they are on.
Now I'm here just to tell you a little bit about the things we utilize inside our patrol vehicles. So to start off, I'll just go with our MDC. This is our computer. We pretty much work out of this, so if we pull somebody over, we have applications we use like Tracks, where we can, you know, put in their information. That's how we write the ticket or the warning, whatever it may be. We also, this is how we respond to our calls. So they'll give us the notes, you know, whether it's a domestic violence or if it's, you know, somebody that we need to help medical wise, it'll give us the address where we need to go to.
This screen up here is gonna be our radio screen. We only have the two channels. It's really one channel. For CVMO and YAPD are on this channel, and this is how we use to talk to it. We either have a headset or the boom mic to talk to the officer.
The way we communicate with our dispatch is we have our radio, which is down here. It's got the knob for the sound or the volume. We've got the mic where I can then talk back to them.
Can you move into another field within the department? Oh yeah. Like I said, I started in evidence or in dispatch, moved into evidence, and then came back into dispatch because I missed it. We've sent a dispatcher to patrol. Patrol officers typically don't come back into dispatch. They are more the on the other side of the radio type people. Has it happened? Not in my tenure here.
Deputy acts as like city police. We remain the name deputy for the history of Camp Verde. and we patrol Camp Verde town limits and take calls as they come in through dispatch. I've always wanted to be a patrol officer, as when I started out at dispatch, taking calls and seeing what they were doing, I knew that's what I wanted to do. As soon as I graduated high school, I just kind of did jobs here and there until I picked up dispatching in 2016. And then you go through a 20-week training academy with up in Prescott. So once you're through the 20 weeks of training, you go to 16 weeks of on-field training, meaning you have another officer present with you at all times, and you're taking the calls and learning as you go on the field.
While we're sitting and doing patrol, and you know we want to just see, make sure everyone's going the right speed, we have what we call our radar, which most people know about these and are not fans of. Normally what we'll have is I'll have it mounted up on my dashboard so that way I'm not using it while I'm driving or if I'm sitting down, and that'll give me the speed of, you know, the vehicles that are passing or if I'm just sitting and watching.
So we work 10-hour shifts right now. Before I prepare for shift, my shift starts at 6 a.m. I prepare by 4:45 a.m. That's when I start the process. You know, getting ready for work. Moment you put this vest and belt on, your attitude completely changes because I'm here for work. So we get ready at home, and then we come in, and through that course, it's either we're taking a call the moment we check on, or we're patrolling the town and just waiting for the call to come out. So it's really, it can range from 10 hours to 14 hours. Just depends on the day. We do use more technology, you know, if it's coming to photography, especially with the detectives part. That is a huge thing that they use. They go through IRLs and all that. Again, with the body cameras, that's mostly the technology we use. We don't dig too deep into it unless we have to investigate the case.
We also have some switches down here, which is the lights that control the inside of the vehicle. So if I have somebody in the back of my patrol car and I want to make sure that they are okay, there's a little switch I can flip back here that'll then light up the back and I can, you know, make sure everything's okay, that they're not doing anything trying to hurt themselves or anything like that.
So this is our evidence area.
So basically these are just temporary holding cells. They're not designed to hold anybody overnight or anything like that. It's if we arrest somebody, bring them in, and we have to do paperwork before we take them to the jail. So we have two separate cells, they're identical. As you can see, not very luxurious, just the bare minimum. And we do have ways of checking in on them to make sure they're okay, and the officers will check on them every so many minutes to make sure that they're okay. The booking area is right here, so this is where they would be doing their booking paperwork to take them to the jail. So they're very close, so you can hear somebody starts banging on the door, says they need to use, you know, they need help or something like that. If it's somebody who's being violent or exhibiting signs that there's, you know, they're gonna be a problem, we'll take them directly to the jail and just bypass here. Sometimes we don't get that luxury and we have to bring them here. We have to do blood draws sometimes if it's like a DUI accident or something like that, so.
I've been in the business 28 years. I started in 1992. And I started in emergency communications, so I was a 911 operator for 20 years. My job entails categorizing all evidence that is impounded by the officers. So whatever they get in the field, they bring it into me. I input it into the system, barcode it, and then store it. If it needs to go to the DPS crime lab, I transfer all that to the DPS crime lab. I want to say currently, we have over 4,000 pieces of evidence. Homicides? We retain all that evidence for 99 plus years. So anything involved in a homicide never goes anywhere. Stays here. Sex offenses are the same way. Many, many, several years. I want to say more than 40 years. Then you have your domestic violence cases that can just go a year. It just all depends on what the state statute is at that time, on what the crime is. So if it's a car that had a dead body in it, that's not a homicide. We'll keep the car until we can get next of kin notification. And of course, they have to go through the process to get power of attorney. And until I have power of attorney from them, then I can't release it. But once they get the release, then there we go, we're good. So whenever I transfer something to the DPS crime lab, it goes up there for analysis. They do their job, they send it back to me. So I transport it up there, they do their business, I go get it and bring it back and house it here again. So depending on like DUIs, could be a couple years. I have blood, I have two freezers that are full of blood, and biological evidence for sex crimes and whatnot, so that's all stored in freezers and coolers. The technology back in the day was everything was paper. So when I started in this business, everything was paper. Dispatch was paper. Audio recordings were done on a cassette, a tape cassette. So yet nowadays, everything is digital. I use a laptop and tablets for all my business. I have a little handheld computer. I track everything in the evidence room. And back in the day, it was all done on paper.
Technology has changed a lot. Even from body camera footage now, to having body cameras, to tasers, to less lethal, those things have changed a lot. The technology for officer safety, being able to track officers and know immediately where they're at. We're getting ready to switch our dispatch to digital, which will help improve the coverage for our officers. So everything costs money, though. This is a very expensive business to be in when it comes to technology, but that protects your citizens and your officers' lives. So I'm liking the advancements that I see. It's just that it seems that everything comes with an $8,000 price tag on it. So from an administrative wise, you have to budget for that. You really have to know that it's improving the public safety for your community in order to invest in that, because it's your taxpayer money that pays for that. I think my business background, honestly, I will say that's probably my strongest point as a marshal, because you have to have a business mind. I control the largest budget in the city, have the most employees in the city, and my strengths in contract negotiations, those type of things. We've literally been able to save thousands and thousands of dollars because of that business background, that I'm able to see that from that perspective. I think that it's been a blessing in my career to be able to have been out of law enforcement for a while, get that business knowledge, and then bring that business knowledge, with my police knowledge together, because it is a business. We run a business every day.
Growing up, it's always the images of the police. They're strict and they're scary. And I've had people come up to me and we just have conversations about tattoos. And it helps when it's, okay, we're more approachable, we're relatable, we're also people. We're not just police officers that are scary. And I've actually helped quite a few people because, like, hey, I like your tattoo, look at mine. And it builds that rapport with people. I wear what is going to protect you and me. Everything I wear is per policy. I don't have anything that's optional. The biggest argument was that it does look more tactical and less approachable. And that's been an issue that we have also been facing, and they even commented that tattoos make you less approachable. I think it's also just turning the image of being more public police and interacting with the public more, wearing this so they say these are still safe people, it's still approachable. These are just tools that we may need to utilize in the future.
I'll go out and cover some shifts during COVID, especially when we were struggling getting my patrol car, and coming down from Alaska here, I was slept with the radio on, so I had to respond. So literally 3.5 years ago, I was sleeping with the radio and responding to calls and making my own arrests and stuff, that on a day-to-day basis, it's mainly administrative.
Every day I see something different, but every day I'm also taking the corrective measures to make sure my officers aren't getting into a dangerous environment. Like right now we're impounding some drugs. They're very dangerous drugs. So I make sure they have the proper materials to do that. Fentanyl is one of the worst things that you can come in contact with right now, and that's what they're impounding right now. So you want to make sure that you're up on that kind of information as well. I do a lot of research, and I belong to a lot of evidence and custodian groups. So the networking is worth $1,000, big time. So
the process, it's very hard to be a chief and run a monarchy. So I set up a command staff. There are three other people that sit with me at the decision-making table. We each have an equal vote. I've been outvoted before. The technology is brought before us, and we review it. What is the cost? What's the overall long-term cost of it? The sustainability of it? What does this technology mean to this community, and will it increase public safety? And I'll give you a for instance. We are one of the only police departments in the state where every one of our officers have an AED in their car, which is the device that helps with people that are having heart attacks. We're usually there before the fire department gets there. This has increased our ability to be able to save people's lives.
We want to make sure that we keep the officers safe. That's my goal, keep my officers safe. Kind of like working in dispatch, that was my goal. Keep, make sure everyone goes home safe, make sure I know where my officers are at all the time. So I kind of do the same thing. You know, some people call it babysitting. I call it making sure my people go home safe.
This is where the officers come in and do reports and do whatever they need to do to get back out on the road. This is the sergeant's office. Currently we have 5 sergeants. We have 4 patrol sergeants and an administrative / criminal investigation sergeant. So he kind of dual hats, and that's you guys met each other. And then we have bathrooms and locker rooms and all that stuff back there. And then that's pretty much it. That's our area. And this sergeant's been dying to talk to you guys.
Hello.
We're the good guys, and that's just what we want to broadcast is, no matter how scared we may look, whether it's me or a 6'4", 200-pound guy, it's, we're all still humans inside, and that's what we want the community to know, especially this town of Camp Verde, for how small it is that we're human, we care about everyone here, and we want to make sure that we get that image across, that we're not just scary people.
There's something about serving your own community that you grew up in. My really strong officers are officers that grew up here. I need more women in law enforcement. I would love to have more women in our police department. They just have a different approach to law enforcement that I think is very healthy. A different view than having a bunch of cops show up, male cops show up. I would encourage females to get into the profession. And obviously schooling, I'm not as much hung up on having a degree to be a cop, although I think education is important. If you do want to further your career path into administration, those degrees are going to be important to have.
I would start looking at taking some classes. There are some property and evidence classes you could take. Get into that kind of environment. That way you know what you're getting into. I mean, it's not as glamorous as everything else in this, in the police world. It's a lot of tedious, time-consuming work. You spend a lot of time staring at a computer, a lot of time. So find the classes that allow you, some criminal justice classes would be good. Something that would pique your interest, because you have a tendency to burn out pretty quick in this environment.
And the favorite part of my job is, I just love crunching numbers. I'm a numbers guy. I can say I love playing with budgets and those type of things. I was horrible in math in school, I will tell you that. But trying to solve a problem, when it comes to like crunching the numbers, like how am I going to be able to get this or attain this? What do I need to do to adjust this and that strategy of it? I think another fun part is watching these officers develop. We have a lot of new young officers. When I came here 3.5 years ago, I brought that motto, the setting the pace, the professionalism, accountability, community, and excellence. I brought that to this department, and we can see that developing. And that's fun to watch that vision that you came here with, to see that actually developing within the department. The hardest part about my job is worrying about my officers.
Spillman itself is not very user-friendly. It's very information-friendly, so it holds so many things that we can go and find from 1,000 years ago if we wanted to. Once you figure it out, it gets pretty easy to navigate through, but it took me a while to pick this up. I'm not a computer person, so that was my hardest part, I feel, on learning this job, was the computer system.
Favorite part of the job? I love my office. I ain't gonna lie. I have good hours. It's a Monday through Thursday gig, and I dig it. I like working with the officers, and I like training the officers. That's the hardest part of my job, is training the officers. So you have to kind of break it down and go a little bit farther on certain steps for certain people. But other than that, once they get it, they're good.
I love being the police officer that I didn't have as a child. So knowing that I can make a difference in a kid's life, where it's, man, I want to be that when I grow up, and set that positive outlook. Again, the hardest part is kids. I have 3 young children, so something happens to a child, I take that to heart. I take it to home, and it's, okay, I need to do my absolute 110% to make sure either this child is done right, and I can go home and say I did everything I possibly could.
You know, it's a commitment that goes beyond just work. So it's something you have to do, like when you're held to a higher standard while you're working, you're held to a higher standard when you're off work, so even when you're with your family. And it's also a commitment that you're gonna have to have with a future spouse or just whatever family you do have. If it's someone that's close to you and that needs you a lot, you know, it's a commitment that they're going to have to give in too. So that's just something that I would put in perspective, because this job requires a lot out of you. And so if you have any family or someone that you care about, definitely talk to them about it too and make sure you're both in on it.
So it was a good job. It's a great job. I would encourage anybody to try it. It's not for everybody. Property management's not for everybody. But you never know until you try it, and once you get into it, you love it. I did. And I said 28 years. Here I am now, I'm 30.
You have to care about your community, be involved and stake in your community. Try it. It's not a job for everybody, but if you're interested in it, go for it.
I say just don't give up. It's a hard process, but it's totally worth it in the end. There's no other job like this. I could never imagine doing anything else.
Don't let it be a frightening thing to you. It will give you the tools you need to know. It's one of those jobs that no matter where you go, anywhere in the world, they need somebody.
It's a really good career. If you want to serve your community at the highest level of putting yourself out there, there's to me nothing nobler than doing it. You gotta be a good communicator. You gotta have patience. And not everything you show up to is a crime, right? You don't always have to put the handcuffs on somebody. You don't always have to write a ticket. It's more about education than it is anything else. If I have an officer who pulls over 10 cars and gives 10 tickets, I'm concerned about that. If he pulls over 10 cars and gives 2 citations, he's educating the public, right? And so you've got to, your drive for this, to come to this profession, has to be something that is a desire to be able to educate and a desire to be able to protect, but also a desire to be able to learn and adapt, right? Because times change.